Thanks. So yes, I'm Cyril Fournet from Microsoft Research, and this is part of a larger research project on TLS and HTTPS in collaboration with INDRIA in Paris. So before going on to the details of TLS, I want to say a few words on our verification method that I'm going to illustrate on the record layer later on. So what we do is essentially to take standardized components or bits of the TLS or HTTPS stack and implement them and build a model of them and prove that this actual implementation is secure. And so the goal is twofold. We want to show that our code is secure, of course, but also to, in the process, to validate the design by being able to have something that is detailed enough so that we can both run it for interop and check that by implementing the design, we get all the security properties we expected. And that's what we are going to do, what I'm going to show today for the TLS 1.2 and 1.3 record layer. So the way it works is we program those components in a language named FSTAR, where we can write the source code, but also the specs, the proofs, the crypto models, and the constructions. And we verify them automatically using the FSTAR type checker that uses Z3 and SMT provers underneath. Then it erases the proof and it generates, it goes to Kremlin, which is the compiler backend that generates low-level predictable C code with reasonable performance and some level of side channel protection. And at that level, we can interop with any other implementations, we can plug and play between components, and we can check that we conform with the standards by testing each other implementations. So here is a small test of what FSTAR looks like. So it's a language oriented towards verification. And for this syntactic example, I have chosen the spec of one of the algorithms used in the TLS 1.3 record, named Poly1305. So it's an authentication algorithm that relies on a polynomial computation in a large prime field. So the specification is actually very simple. So this slide contains the full specification of the algorithm on which you are going to make the crypto assumptions. At the same time, to implement it efficiently, the implementation uses lower level representations that are carefully optimized for the different lengths and how to propagate carries and so on. And so it amounts for a few thousand lines of code and proof to show that that code is correct. But at the same time, once you check that this functional correctness proof is okay, you only need to care about the specifications to continue with the security proof. So why verifying this code? Well, it's possible to get it wrong. In fact, in the recent implementation in OpenSSL, there were quite a few defects on that one, ranging from computing the wrong values to buffer overruns in the implementation. So we don't do only safety and functional correctness, we also look at security properties. And for that, we adopt a rather standard computational model of cryptography, where we write games to express both our assumptions and what we prove about the functionalities that we implement. So the one here is for authenticated encryption, which is at the core of the record layer in TLS. And we transcribe those games into FSTAR games, parameterized by Boolean B, which is kept hidden for the verification purposes. And that says whether we are encrypting using the real implementation or idealizing it by generating random values instead. And so the FSTAR code strictly corresponds to the game, the written in pseudocode. And on it, we can employ our type checking methodology to extract properties and use them to prove further properties towards the TLS top level API. So after this very brief presentation, let us of the method, let us scale up towards the TLS. So the approach is the same, meaning that you are going to write and develop intermediate functionalities for all the crypto assumptions that we make and for all the intermediate steps of the construction. At the same time, there is a lot of details to account for. So TLS features multiple algorithms and constructions so that if one breaks or one is unimplemented somewhere, you can switch to another. So that's cryptographic agility, which is necessary in practice, but a source of complexity. Also, TLS uses many keys for different purposes. So we have to account for the multiplexing between different keys. The security is conditional because some of those keys may be compromised and not others. and some of the algorithms may be bigger than others. So we need a fancier compromise model. And then there are all the standard implementation details, like the message format with the record headers, what are the actual bytes passed for authentication, and so on, plus the mechanism for fragmenting messages into records that fit for TCP, and the padding, both for confidentiality of the length and for matching the length of the block ciphers. Finally, encryption in TLS is stateful because we don't really care about just authenticating encryption. For a message, what we want is to authenticate a full stream of messages in both directions. So we need to keep state, which complicates a bit the formalization. So is it worth the trouble? Well, if you look at the record for TLS, it's not only complicated, but it got wrong quite a few times. So there is a long track of various implementation flaws in the record layer causing serious attacks. There are also attacks on the cryptography getting weaker. So there is still, in earlier version of TLS, a mix of older algorithms like MD5 or SHA-1. Then some of the historic constructions of TLS are actually shown to be pretty weak. So the classic TLS 1.2 construction is MAC, then encode, then encrypt, which is not that secure, and that causes many side channel attacks that are persisting till today. Moreover, in the way the interface is used, there are room for attack based on compressions and also on truncation, where some messages are discarded. And also, it does not cause a decryption failure. Only a prefix of what was intended to be communicated is received by the other end. So, largely to address this collection of issues, there is a new design for TLS. TLS now dubbed 1.3, and that's a rather deep revision of the protocol. So for the first time, all the mechanisms have been systematically reviewed and reconsidered. So there is a more modern design. Many of the problematical constructions are completely dropped, and we get a much better deal in terms of trade-offs between performance and security. Also, from our viewpoint, for developing verified components, it's an excellent opportunity because everyone needs a new implementation, and we would like to be there as early as possible with something as verified as we can. Also, and conversely, we would really like to find any flaws in the design or in the standard before it's done into an official RFC. And so, in fact, the IETF was specifically interested in us doing some verification for the record layer, which has received relatively little attention compared to the key establishment mechanisms that Karthik is going to talk about in the next talk. So what's new? So the MAC encode and encrypt construction is gone, which is a relief. And instead, there are variants of authenticating encryption with additional data used to encrypt multiple flows of the protocol. So one of the novelty is that the handshake is now encrypted. And so the multiplexing between the different sub-protocols of TLS occurs after, or before encryption and after decryption. So now there is a new message format with the content type being placed in the middle of the plain text between the actual message and the padding to be encrypted. And because there is encryptions for the handshake and for other messages, there are now many more keys than before. And what to do with each of the keys is one of the challenges of this verification effort. So for performance, the main novelty is to provide a way to cut in the number of round trips. So that's great for improving the latency. So in TLS 1.2, you had to run a full handshake, unless you got lucky, before you could start sending application data. So in TLS 1.3, you already get something that cuts one round trip by packaging the message a bit better. And moreover, you can start sending data from the very first message of the protocol. So as you start your client hello message and start negotiating, if you think you know what the key is going to be, or part of the key materials, you can start encrypting and pushing application data to the receiver. And similarly, at the server side, as soon as you receive the first message from the client, you can start responding by using the keys that will be established later by the client. immediately. So it's great for performance. It's interesting from a security viewpoint because clearly you get weaker guarantees. So in particular, there is no way to prevent replays from the client messages to multiple servers. So how to prevent replays and how to deal with replays on the server side is one of the delicate issues for deployment. And more generally, what happens when you have multiple servers connecting to one client, at least for the first messages. For the 0.5 traffic sent by the server knows that there is a client that is live, but what it doesn't know is whether the client will agree on the connection parameter. So again, there is a higher level of risk than waiting for the handshake to complete. And we wanted to be able to reason precisely about the trade-offs with these different kinds of keys at different stages of the exchange. So this is a picture of the TLS record layer as we had its modular structure in F-star as we modeled and implemented it. So at each level, we start from the crypto primitives and verify the implementation of those primitives. Then we build up to authenticated encryptions. Then we have stateful stream encryption on streams of fragments. Then we have length hiding and multiplexing between streams, on top of which we have the management of multiple keys in the record layer, and then the higher level protocols for the handshake and for the application. And for the rest of the talk, I'm going to focus on one layer, which is the stateful stream encryption built out of a PRF and a one-time MAC. For the rest of the steps, please refer to the paper. Okay, so quite classically, I'm going to give you an idea of the security definitions for this layer, what the new constructions are, what are our main results in terms of concrete security bounds and verifications, and then give you an idea of the performance that we get for our verified code. So this depicts the game definition that we use, so I don't have the code for it, but you can find it in the paper. So it's just a variant, an elaboration of authenticated encryption. So we have plain text messages, and those messages will be fragmented and sent in a smaller unit. So you encrypt, you get ciphertext, you use the untrusted network to transmit it, and on the other end you decrypt, and you reassemble the traffic. So that's the real definition. So the ideal definition, as usual, relies on a log that records all the messages that are sent, that are encrypted and decrypted. And instead of encrypting the real values, what happens is the encryptor generates a random value, a fresh random value, and records that in the table together with the plaintext. And conversely, the receiver, instead of decrypting, does a table lookup in this magical table shared between senders and receivers to decrypt. And so one can argue that if we take the blue definition of stream encryption, you get perfect integrity for the traffic and confidentiality because the actual secrets never go to the network, only their links do, and only things in the table can be read at the receiver. So at least the receiver is reading at most a prefix of what has been sent. So that's the target, that's what you want to prove on our implementation of stream encryptions for TLS. So to this end, we look at the standard, and it refers to various constructions for AEID. And we focus on two constructions, the one using AEIGCM and the one using ChaCha20 Poly 1305. And the good news is that their structure is very similar. So in fact, you have a proof that covers both and that is parameterized by the cipher that you use to generate blocks and by the field that you use to do the multiplicative MAC for authentication. So we could do most of the proof at a generic level, which was so that's the construction that we use for the protocol. So it relies on a clever use of the cipher used as a PRF to generate one-time use key materials for the record layer, so that you have a fresh key for the multiplicative MAC for every message that you are going to send. And because that key is used only once, you can just have to do this multiplicative MAC for authentication, which is more efficient than a full MAC as in prior constructions. So we rely on two standard assumptions. So one of them is that the cipher behaves like a PRF. The other one is that the one-time MAC provides authentication against chosen message attacks when used exactly once. And you will find in the paper all the details about the constructions. and approved based on the two fields used in the standard. The construction takes generically one cipher and one field to compute the multiplicative MAC, plus injective definitions for the message encodings used for authenticating materials. And for that, we show functional correctness, we show security, getting back to the ideal functionality for stream encryption that I have shown. And we get security bounds for each of the three concrete instantiations used in the TLS draft. So that involves many kinds of proofs. So we need to prove very precise functional correctness for the cryptography we use. Then we need to switch using those cryptographic games. Then we have injectivity proofs. Then we have loops for the fragmentation and the sequence of blocks used in the encryption of a single fragment. Then the multiplexing towards the TLS API. So the concrete bound is computed just by summing the bounds that we have for the two assumptions that we rely on. So that's quite easy, but we can get the precise numbers. And that's useful because on the TLS mailing list, there was a big debate about when and how you need to rekey because you have encrypted too many times with AES-GCM. And so we have a precise analysis, and we can show that if you use the rekeying mechanism of TLS 1.3 every 2 to the 24 encryptions, then you get the strongest security using AES-GCM. When using ChaCha20 poly1305, the constants are bigger, so there is never any need to do rekeying, except maybe for forward secrecy. So let's have a look now at performance. So we tested interop with several other implementations of TLS 1.2 and TLS 1.3. So those are the numbers we got for the initially for the verified implementation, the fully verified implementation that we have for stream encryption. So you can see compared to OpenSSL, the C versions of OpenSSL. As you can see, for new algorithms like ChaCha20 poly1305, we are quite competitive with 13 cycles instead of 10 per byte. For things like AES-GCM that heavily rely on hardware acceleration, generating C code is hopeless. So it works, but it's much slower than what you can get using architecture-specific implementation. We also measure the throughput for reading 1 gigabyte of data from a local server. And the first column gives the time it takes before we had our C backend compiling to OCaml, so that was super slow. Now, compiling to C, we get very high throughput, but it's still slower than OpenSSL or curl, but not by an order of magnitude. So we are actively working on performance. So here are the today's numbers for these things integrated with our Verify framework. So we bump up the speed quite a lot for ChaCha poly1305. We also got a massive speed up for AES-GCM by starting to link what we do to some bit of verified X64 code for AES provided by Vail, which is also part of our project. And for the number of cycles per byte, using the latest variant of ACLSTAR, which is our verified crypto provider, we are now down to 8 or 9 cycles per byte, which is, and we expect to get very close to the best performing implementation in that area and still retain all the benefits of functional and security verification. So because we are verifying deep properties, there is a high cost in terms of annotations and also a high verification cost on the backend. So it takes almost 2 hours to recheck all the proofs. Also, for now, we still have a mix between a code compiled to C, which is most of what I have described, and code compiled to OCaml, which is what we use for the handshake. And we are working on integrating the two. Okay, so thanks.
So I have a quick question.
Thanks.
Did you think about how this would be applicable, for example, to Qwik?
Yes, very good questions. We are looking at it carefully. It's very much applicable, at least at the handshake level. So the handshake is the same, and so we have just started to experiment with it. For the authenticated encryption, it's also the same. So most of what we do up to the stream encryption applies essentially unchanged. Now, the way the keys are scheduled and the way you use 1RTT, 0RTT, and the like, all those details are different. So that will require some specific work to get strong guarantees. In particular, last time I checked, Quick was very aggressive at using 0RTT silently without telling the applications, and that has to be dangerous. So we need to check actually how they send a signal to the application to say toujours the transition between relatively weak key and stronger keys with forward secrecy.
Thank you.
Thanks.